I'm Peter Brown from Tiny & Sons Glass. Tiny & Sons Glass was established in 1978 with my father and brother and I. We're at 575 Washington Street in Pembroke. We're certified and qualified to do all your windshield replacement and repair. Tiny & Sons Glass is a community-based business. We have 12 mobile vans that come to you. If the weather's bad, you can come here to the shop. We have a nice waiting area, TV, Wi-Fi, kid-friendly, pet-friendly. We also can move about 15, 20 cars a day through the shop. Perfect for you when the weather's bad. So come on down to Tiny & Sons Glass if you need your windshield replaced or repaired. Tiny & Sons Glass, 1-888-64-TINIES. Just call. Thank you.
I'm Arthur Boyle of Performance Appraisal Services. We're residential real estate appraisers with a company founded in 1994 by Mike Gianelli and I in the basement of my house in Malden. We've since grown to have offices in Malden and Pembroke. We serve the Eastern Mass counties, including Cape Cod. A good client for us is an attorney or a private landowner or a private property owner who's going through a probate process or a divorce division of property. Call us at 781-293-6900. Ask for Arthur Boyle or Amanda Boyle Grazioso. Our first name is Performance.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Pembroke Board of Selectmen's meeting of Monday, April 3rd. We'll begin with the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please note that this meeting is being made available to the public through a live video and audio broadcast on Comcast Government Access Channel 15 and is being recorded for broadcast at future dates. Comments made in open session will be recorded. We have an announcement, Dan.
Yes, I do, Mr. Chairman. Household Hazardous Waste Collection Day will be held at the Pembroke Recycling Center on Saturday, April 15th from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. Items which are acceptable and not acceptable are listed on the town website at www.pembroke-mass.com. You must be a town resident and have a current recycling sticker, and you cannot dispose of business or commercial hazardous waste.
Thank you, Dan. I have a short announcement I'd like to make as well. I've been told that on Monday, April 10th, construction will begin again from the Hanson Town line down to Route 53. The project that we all know about is going to be starting up again. The projected date is a week from today, weather permitting. So that'll be good to see the men out there working on this project, and hopefully we can see some progress made that we're all aware of, and so let's hope the weather holds. Thank you. First item tonight on the agenda is to consider the reappointment of Lisa Hullity as Animal Inspector. The Commonwealth of Massachusetts Division of Animal Health requires that the selectmen for the town of Pembroke reappoint the Animal Inspector under Section 15 of Chapter 129 of Mass General Laws. So we have Lisa with us tonight. So would you like to speak?
I serve at the will of the town. If the board sees fit to appoint me, I'm happy to serve, and if not, I'm happy to not.
Mr. Good. Chairman.
Yes, go ahead, Arthur.
I'd place into nomination the name of Lisa Cullity as the Animal Inspector for the town of Pembroke. It is our appointment, and the Board of Health erroneously thought it was theirs.
Second. Now we have a motion by Arthur and a second by Bill. But we have a question from the Board of Health.
May I speak, please?
Yes, you may.
Okay.
Could they come up front, please?
Yes. Dan, could you give these up?
Sure thing.
All right. Before the vote is taken to approve the inspection position, I would like to ask the board if you plan on incorporating the animal inspection position into the health agent's job duties. the animal inspection duties that I just gave you clearly states that this is a job that is to be done between 8:30 and 4:30 during working hours. We've already signed a contract with our health agent to work within these times. These are two different payrolls, and I would ask that this board consider reviewing the animal inspector's position and the conflicts of the two payrolls that derive from this position. I would also like to see if the selectmen would postpone this vote to review the position and to add some clarity as to whether or not these jobs do overlap, as again they are two different payroll identities.
After you made the motion, would you like to have a question?
There are political things at work here that I don't think are measured in dollars. We have fiscal realities that measure that. Lisa has done a good job. Many towns have the animal inspector as the health agent. Some do not. The town I work in does not. So it's not something that is a majority one way or the other. And I think this is just a political way of getting back at Lisa Cullity for doing a good job.
Mr. Boyle, I would like to change your direction on this. This has nothing to do with politics. It has two.
It has everything to do with politics. And if Columbus had had you as a guide, he would have discovered Japan.
Mr. Boyle, that is hostile. Could you please just...
You should know hostile. You've created a hostile workplace in that office as well, and you're going to get us sued.
Mr. Boyle, would you please stick to what we are at the issue of today? The issue of today is we have two payrolls being given to one employee, and I'm asking you to consider at this point how to make it legal.
We have many employees that get two paychecks.
I thank you, Board, for the Board, for your consideration. Certainly, you do have the right to do this, but again, I will implore you that it is not an ethical thing to do.
Well, being told about ethics,
are you a question?
Oh yeah, just wanted to comment on it that so the animal inspector, not only in the town of Pembroke, but probably every single town in Massachusetts, is a part-time job that's done by someone typically who works in town already.
Correct.
In most cases, that's how it works. So the health inspector in our town is dedicated to town service, is attuned to what's going on in town, is also has a good rapport with our animal control officer, and is a good fit for this position. So for our choice that's been nominated, Lisa, who's actually has been doing this and been doing a commendable, if not great job at it already, I think the board should continue to have her. So it's not to say it's unethical. That's not correct.
Being told about ethics by her, Dan, is like being told about dining tips from Jeffrey Dahmer.
It is.
I want to keep this to. My part of it, I want to keep this to. The person I believe that's most qualified to do this position right now is not only the health inspector, but the person who is the health inspector, who is Lisa. And I think she's the one who is capable and qualified to do this work. And it's also a precedent, not only in this town, but in nearly every single other town, to have someone in a dual role capacity. So it's not unheard of. In fact, it's the norm.
I understand that you can have a dual role capacity. I also understand that right now the Board of Health, we're leasing out our inspections are being done by other people because we do not have the time for our health agent to complete this position. 90% of our inspections are being done are being contracted out. I don't understand if we're going to contract a position out, if we're going to spend this money on the Board of Health for our food safety, why are we giving her another duty when the duties are already stringent on her, her plates are already overfull?
Yeah, and I'd like to look into that further. This might not be the moment for that, but if that is occurring, we could look into it. Okay. But also, the animal inspector's duties go beyond the 8 to 4, 9 to 5 type of job. So we all do know that if there's a rabid raccoon, it could happen anytime.
I understand.
At any time. So it's not a 9 to 5 job.
The other
Bill, is that a question?
I just have one comment that you probably find, like, the police chief is also the emergency management director,
mm-hmm.
and the fire chief is the forest warden, and he's also an emergency management director. So sometimes you might even have two or three different roles of one person in the town, and I think that fits in the Board of Health. That
may I
that
ask, is that all under the same payroll? Is it all under the same category, the same payroll? No.
Ed could answer that.
No, it's not, but you didn't do the research, just like you didn't do it on this last one either last week, and now you're here trying to reverse what you said a week ago.
I thank you, gentlemen, for your time.
Yes.
I just would like to make a point clarification. We have John Abagny, chairperson, Pembroke Board of Health.
Thank you.
For our food inspections, every single establishment has to be inspected that deals with any type of food service. I do not know the total off the top of my head.
I do.
May I please? I would.
Stats. I only retain 5 inspections that I do personally, only for expediency, the schools, because they also get a pre-operational opening inspection that is difficult to schedule with the short turnaround from the time that the janitors actually show up to open the schools to when the school doors are open to the public. That is done as a cost-saving measure by the school admin. Obviously, having an open school without kids in it is costly. You don't do that. That is the only reason I retain those. The practice of subbing out, as it's called, food service inspections is done in almost every town. Just for example, we were the last town to begin this. This was done in Hanover for over 15 years. It's been done in Halifax for over 7 or 8 before we started it. It's a measure to save money. The average food inspector receives a stipend, a flat stipend of $50 an inspection. My compensation package to the town alone for an hour of my time far exceeds that. The idea of subbing out these inspections is a cost savings measure, not a cost escalation to the town.
And I think that we did a couple of meetings ago, we did a quick calculation. If she was to dedicate her time as a full-time basis of doing the 2 inspections twice a year of all the establishments, it would be 13 to 14 full
400 hours. About 2.5 months worth of time.
Worth of time that's taking our health agent away from the issues that she needs to focus on. So I just want to make a point clarity of what was previously said in regards to subbing out and our health agent not having enough time. It was done due to the resources of having somebody on site in this building for the people of Pembroke on a need as need basis.
What, before you go, can I ask who pays for those inspections?
We do.
They come out of the Board of Health.
We have an operational budget.
Do the restaurants pay an inspection fee?
They pay a licensing fee every year. Yes. Does it cover that? Yes.
Right. So essentially the restaurants are paying for the inspections.
Correct.
Not the taxpayers.
Not the taxpayer. But it comes out of our operating budget because it comes in as fees.
And then it's reimbursed in fees.
It's set up, it goes into the general fund like most collected revenues. It's not an isolated revolving account, but there is a line item that is set up within our budget that accommodates that, yes.
Right. Okay. So
The
town of Pembroke,
the
town of Pembroke is compensated for these inspections.
Correct, through the collection from the fees of the restaurant.
I'm asking a question I already knew, but I wanted to make sure the public knew it as well.
Point taken.
Okay,
thank you.
Before we proceed with the vote, I'd just like to say to the public that in the packet of information that we have concerning this item is a job description, is a list of qualifications, some detail on what the animal inspector's job is. So we have that information before us prior to coming here tonight. So I think we're well versed to know what this job entails. And also I would like to mention that if the Board of Health would like to change the way that we appoint the animal inspector, you, the Board of Health could put forth an article, not for this upcoming town meeting, but from the one in the fall would be the earliest time you could do it. If you so choose that you feel that you are better qualified to make an appointment of this position, then you have that opportunity. But right now, it lies with this board.
Until that mass law is until it goes to town, in front of the town, as an item.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So having all the information before us, we have a motion on the floor, and it's been seconded. Is there any other questions from the board? Hearing none, all those in favor of appointing Lisa Cullity as the animal inspector, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, hearing none, that's 4-0.
Mr. Chairman, I would ask if we could ask Mrs. Cullity if she accepts the position.
I would, and understand that if this board wants to change its mind any time, I'm happy to assist with that as well, but I'm proud to serve.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. We'll move on to the next item on our agenda is to review some remaining articles and vote recommendations for the annual town warrant. And the information that we have before us has been broken down to bundle items of like together and to help us come to a recommendation in the best possible way. The first one is we have general and zoning bylaw amendments. There's four articles. Article 11, to consolidate the muni inspections. Article 13 is a special events permitting. And Article 18 is gonna be handled by the Planning Department. It's a zoning bylaw amendment for the center protection. And there's a second one regarding the mixed use, which is currently in place. So do I have any questions from the board on those articles, or can we get a recommendation on how we're going to vote those articles?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I would recommend that the board vote on Article 11, favorable action.
I would move that for the board.
Yes, we have an article to a motion, excuse me, for Article 11, favorable action. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Dan. All those in favor,
excuse
please
me,
say aye.
For Article 11, would it be prudent? We have, this was put forth from the Town Government Study Committee.
Right.
And we just happen to have a member here. Would it be beneficial to the board to have a brief explanation from the Town Government Study Committee? A member, he's not the chairman, but if he wouldn't mind speaking briefly.
Certainly.
In favor of this article, I expect you would speak in favor. Would you mind, Tim?
Sure.
Thank you, Dan. Yeah, I think it's a good idea. The public doesn't have this information in front of them, so we'll hear from,
sure,
from you. Thank you.
So Article 11, the goal of that is to kind of consolidate inspectional services within the town. Right now, that's kind of segmented throughout Town Hall. So in talking with Ed and Dan and the other people on the Town Government Study Committee, and we've also spoken to Hanover, who have gone down this road several years ago. This was kind of the first step they took in kind of making some changes to the structure of their town government to consolidate and make the process more streamlined. This is kind of this is the article we put forth. So it would consolidate It would create a Department of Municipal Inspections, which would be headed by Mr. Thorne, which would allow for more streamlined processes within the inspectional services for the town, which we think would be beneficial for people working with the town that needs those and businesses within the town. So it's hard for me, you know, Ed could probably speak to it better, but logically when I think about this, it makes a lot of sense. And I think when we talk to a lot of people about how things have been set up for so long, it's surprising that we've done as well as we have not having this structure in place. So I think it's hard for me. I always try to think about, you know, what's the other side of the argument here. I feel like there's almost no downside. It really just makes things more streamlined and allows kind of things in town hall to operate. It makes people's lives easier who work in town hall, and it will make people's lives easier who come to town hall to look for particular services.
Good. Yes.
And one thing that we want to make clear, and I'm sure Tim and Lisa and Dan at town meeting, we're not asking any of those elected boards to give up any statutory authority. It's just that on a day-to-day basis, this would allow the public to have access to two or three individuals that are trained in the operations of three to four inspectional services departments. So in the absence of a charter and an absence of a change of the town bylaws, this amendment to the town bylaw would allow that day-to-day operations to go forward, still giving the elected boards their statutory authority regarding certain items.
Right. I think too, in talking with a lot of board members, a lot of them don't want to be involved in day-to-day operations of their board and administrating the board. They're more concerned in kind of big picture policy decisions. So this kind of would alleviate some of that pressure from them and let them focus on the bigger policy issues and have somebody like Ed manage the day-to-day stuff.
Sure, and
yes, and
for the board and the public's knowledge, this concerns the folks that are working here in town hall full time during the day, and just as the board of selectmen are, the other elected boards in town are part time volunteer elected boards. So for a part time board that meets once a week and once every 2 weeks in some cases to run a full-time staff member, it's impossible. So we need someone in town who can administer the day-to-day operations, and we have someone with the title town administrator. So it makes sense that that's the person that administers the folks that work in town full-time, and that's all that this article is trying to do. And I wanted to make sure that someone who represents the Town Government Study Committee, as Tim does, could speak to it so that the town knows that this is not a Board of Selectmen pushing an agenda forward. This is something that was studied by the Town Government Study Committee, a group of citizens, myself, I was on the board as well, the committee as well. But I want to make sure that this was brought forth from citizens who have studied it. I expect this board are in favor of it as well and would like to move it forward, but it's important for the folks to know that this is came independently from the Board of Selectmen.
Very good. Tatha, question?
No, I actually have a statement because I read Tim's letter in the paper, and I think it also saves on overtime. It's cross-training, which is a great thing for an inspectional services department. And you've got virtually no downtime for certain departments. So I think you hit a home run with this, to be honest with you.
I think it's I think kind of having sat on advisory for a few years now, I think really there's kind of nothing more important for the town to kind of really think about how it's organized and make sure we spend time thinking about how we can make it organized better so people within town hall can operate, they can do their job better, and people working in town hall can do can expect more and get more from the town. So I think this is a good first step in that direction.
It's funny, we just the Board of Selectmen just received an email from a citizen wondering how we can better town services without raising my taxes, the gentleman said.
It's a good start.
This does that.
Yeah, it's a good start.
Very good. Thank you, Tim. So we have a motion for favorable action on Article 11. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none. Article 13 is a special events permitting article. And what this is intended to do is to define the procedures and notification process necessary to ensure a safe and streamlined method if an event is going to occur on a public way or a public property or private property, but may affect traffic flows or cause a rise in public interest. I'm reading from the article. So what we're trying to accomplish with this is, if someone is going to have a public event that may have a lot of people going to it, it could be an issue with parking, with traffic, maybe the fire department has to know about it, certainly the selectmen would like to know about it. We currently don't have a permitting process in place for this kind of an event, and we're just trying to let the people know the event is going on and that we've covered public service safety issues. So is there any questions from the board on Article 13? Bill?
I just have one question. These special events permitting, would this be a fee for the special permit?
I don't believe so. Is there, Mr. Fenn?
I don't think there's a fee associated with this bylaw.
No, but every other undesignated license, it carries a $25 charge. I mean, it's absolutely up to the board, ultimately, how it's implemented in your office. But sometimes that's just to cover the cost of administering it, not to gain any kind of profit from
No, what I'm saying is, what I think it is, it's a good idea, because if you have a special event, and we are paying for other services, to have this event that's costing the town, then it might be well worthwhile to charge. I mean, it's I know when I got married down the Cape, I went to town hall looking for a permit to get married on the beach down there, and they never had a special permit fee for getting married on the beach or whatever, but they started one. So it was, that wouldn't hurt either. I mean, we're looking for extra money here and there around town for doing certain things. So, maybe that's something that we could do, whatever that fee would be, to take care of cost. And
if I could just expand on that a little bit, Bill, there's a list of conditions, and in number 5, it does note that it'll be the applicant's responsibility for the additional required services of details needed. So right now it doesn't show any mechanism for covering administrative costs like what Sabrina does or the Board of Selectmen may do, but it does put the onus on paying for police or fire details on the applicant. So that's important for the folks to know, even if we don't get the $25 fee for the administrative costs. Any police detail is their responsibility.
Yeah, what we'd like to do with this bylaw is to alert the Board of Selectmen's office that some type of an event is being planned, and it'll be up to us to determine if the police chief should know, the fire chief should know, the DPW should know, and it's all geared around making the event happen and not have any bad effects happen because of it. It's just a form that will have to be filled out. So any other questions on Article 13? Can I have a motion on that for an action?
I move to for town meeting floor recommendation.
The town meeting floor recommendation. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Bill. Any questions? All those in favor?
Question.
Yes.
I would rather have positive. I think this board should have a positive recommendation on this. I mean, we are putting this forth. It's really consolidating things that we do now, almost on an ad hoc basis. When someone comes in, we're already doing this. It's just codifying what we've been doing. So I would rather have the selectmen go to town meeting with an affirmative recommendation read on town meeting.
All right, I'll withdraw my motion in favor of Dan's.
I move favorable action.
Okay, Arthur's motion is withdrawn. Dan is making a motion for favorable action. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Arthur. All those in favor?
Aye.
No.
Bill is opposed. 3 for and 1 against. Article 18 is a zoning bylaw change in the Center Protection District. Any questions from anybody on this article?
I had a question for this and the next one. Has the planning board submitted their recommendation yet after their public hearings?
They've recommended favorable action, but they are considering on town meeting floor
amending
it to put in some dates as to when these things would take effect.
I move town meeting floor for Articles 18 and 19.
Second.
Okay, motion for town meeting floor by Arthur, seconded by Dan. All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none. It's unanimous. Now we have a group of articles that have to deal with financial requests. Raises, appropriations, transfer, or borrowing. There's 6 articles. I think Mr. Fawn is recommending that we take no action on these.
That's correct. Based on conversations that we've had, that Mr. Buckley, town accountant, and I have had with all of the department heads, with advisory, and that conversation will continue when you adjourn this meeting and I go upstairs. But we, along with all the departments that have requested these amounts, I am recommending to the board that Articles 14, 15, 16, 22, 23, and 24, the board vote take no action on these money articles.
You want to just table them for a week, or you want to take no action, period?
Take no action, period.
Okay, is there a motion after hearing from the town administrator?
The town administrator's recommendation.
A motion by Arthur to vote, take no action on Article 14, 15, 16, 22, 23, and 24. Is there a second?
I'll second for discussion. I think we should speak about this a little more here today.
Seconded by Dan for discussion. Go ahead, Dan.
Right, so I think it's important for the Board of Selectmen to consider every single article that's on the warrant and make a recommendation when you have all the information to make a recommendation, either up or down, while we're sitting here, so that we can defend our decision on town meeting floor. For some of these, I don't think we have enough information to do that here today. But I think we need the information. So I'm going to put it to the town administrator. What further information do we need, or what could we have in the future that would help us make a decision on this?
Well, for starters, the budget that we have right now that was presented to advisory and the Board of Selectmen is balanced to the nickel. So these items are asking for additional monies. So whether or not we can afford them from raising appropriate or from transferring of funds or borrowing, there is no money to do any of those things. Now, all of the departments that are proposing these items are prepared to go before town meeting, explain why they need that, and then withdraw the article. So they want to be assured that they have the backing of the Board of Selectmen. Now, I'll state that this year, there will be a 15-minute presentation made by either the town accountant or myself regarding the status of the town's budget at the beginning of the meeting, and that we will have the financial plan on the screen that shows where all the money's coming from to pay for the projects, and the fact that none of these, even if we borrow money for some of these items, there is no room to borrow that kind of money. And so all of the departments that have proposed these things are prepared to go in front of town meeting to explain, because we are looking at a year-long process to explain to the town why they, while there'll probably be a need for an operational override a year from now.
So expand on that just a little bit for me, Ed. These are going to be on the warrant. The Board of Selectmen could pull these from the warrant.
Good.
But the thought is, leave them on the warrant, the Board of Selectmen going into town meeting with the recommendation that they are take no action, they're not voted on, but leave them on the warrant so that the discussion can be held on town meeting floor, and then it's the intent of the protagonists for each one to pull them on town meeting floor or to argue for them on town meeting floor?
To pull them.
No, the motions are being drafted as to the chief would say, I move to take no action after presenting his case.
So that's...
We want to explain in that public forum and the start of many public forums why he needs two police officers, why the fire chief needs four, why the extrication, I'm going to have a tough time with that word this day. You know, why all these can be postponed. Now, is there a need for them right away? Yes. They all acknowledge that there is no room in the town budget to pay for these items at this time. And they understand that. And the conversation that I had with those departments today, again, was that that is, in essence, what the game plan is going to be for those particular articles.
For all six?
Correct.
So is there a possible scenario that, whether it's police chief, fire chief, or library director, stands up in town meeting floor, states that they want these, they propose that these have take no, the town meeting takes no action to these, and then someone in the public stands up and says, no, I want this to go through, and it's a possibility that because they're on the warrant, no matter what the police or fire chief says, the town could vote on it to vote these monies through.
We did discuss that. We did discuss the fact that somebody would stand up and do that. Now, in the case of advisory and the Board of Selectmen and the department, if those three entities are all unified, then that would be the conversation that we would have to turn that down. But they wanted that. They wanted the forum at town meeting to explain that this is something that they will need in the future. They are willing to wait 1 year, but this is the long range needs of the town, and in the next 9-10 months before we actually decide on health insurance, which is another major issue for the town to face, that we have 1 year to put together the game plan, and we're looking at the a 5-year plan.
I would be in favor of the Board of Selectmen voting to take no action on this only if each one of these articles had a summary attached to them explaining just that. That these articles are put on for informational purposes, with the intent that no action will be taken at this town meeting.
Right.
Something to that effect.
Mm-hmm. I don't have a problem with it as long as it says something to the fact that we don't have the money. I mean, it's, we agree also that they do need new police and fire and equipment. And the other three articles, I mean, there is a need for that. But if there isn't any money, I don't know where we're going to get it.
Yeah, and I think it's important for people to understand that these departments are all in this together. You know, they acknowledge that, and they are willing to stand united in saying that we know that we don't have any money at this point. You know, the two major things that are going to happen between the school department and the town government is funding collective bargaining agreements for the school department and collective bargaining agreements for the town side. And obviously paying the 12% increase for health insurance. Those are the three main things that have been addressed in the budget. And the other things right now are just gonna have to be put aside for 1 year while the town puts together a game plan for operations for the next 5 years.
Well, we have heard from the police and the fire, the librarian, about what they believe that they need. And after hearing from them, it was my personal opinion that we needed to fund these now. So I talked to Ed and I went to a meeting with all the department heads and I sat there and I listened to them, and they did say, as Ed pointed out, that they were willing to wait. However, my attitude then and my belief was that we should go for an operational override immediately, meaning in May. And but then after I listened to them, and as Ed's pointed out, they had a game plan that did not include going for an operational override now, but to wait a year. So reluctantly, I dropped my case for going for the override now. They're the ones that are running these departments, and I have to respect what they say. And so I'm willing to go along with what Ed has said. And Dan, you wanted to add to that motion that we add something to these articles?
Every warrant article comes with a summary. And I want the summary on these six to include the explanation that these are put on the warrant for informational purposes, with the intent that they will be withdrawn or voted to take no action to, whichever the better wording is, Ed. And I'll leave that to you. And also to include, as Bill mentioned, that the reasons for that is there is no money available either in hand or to be borrowed. So that's important information for the people when they're looking at this. As we know, there are folks that come to town meeting who are reading these for the first time. So if the summary includes that, they understand the intent, and there wasn't a last minute deal on town meeting floor that the police, fire chief, or library director are pulling their articles off. It's a concerted effort from all departments in town, including the Board of Selectmen and town administrator, to get the information out there with a greater goal in mind for next year.
Okay.
So that's the only addition I would make to that motion.
So we would have a motion of take no action along with a summary as Dan has defined that wording to be. So do we have a motion for that?
I would move the town administrator's recommendation.
Second.
Second by Dan. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, hearing none. Moving on to conservation and CPC articles. We have three. Article 25 is a final payment to conservation of $5,000 for the four property reimbursement. This has gone on for several years to pay them back for a loan that they made to the town to settle a lawsuit. Article 26 is allocating the annual revenues from the CPC, and then also Article 27 is a number of CPC projects that we have before us. Is there any questions about these articles? Hearing none, is there a motion on action to take?
I just have a question on, is this to pay the $5,000 or not?
Yeah, there's $5,000 left to be paid back to the Conservation Commission.
Does this mean?
But the conservation agent said that in the spirit of what the department heads are doing, right, you can wait till the fall for that money. So the message is consistent across the board.
So would we take no action on these three articles?
Just the first one.
Just the first one.
So Article 25 is the repayment to conservation of a loan they made several years ago of $5,000. So we need
take no action.
We have a motion from Bill to take no action.
Second.
Second by
Question.
Questions.
So I think the Board of Selectmen had been doing what we promised to do by paying off this loan. So this is the final payment. Will we have the money in the fall to make this final payment?
That's the plan.
Okay. Make sure. We went to great lengths to pay this back, mm-hmm. and the Conservation Commission went to great lengths to give us a loan when the town was in a pinch. So I just want to make sure we make good on that promise.
And as Sabrina said, it's great that the conservation agent, you know, like she mentioned, in the spirit of all the other people holding the line, is willing to wait till the fall.
I think that's a very good example of how the departments are working together, as they have always done. But when financial things get tight, it can get a little ugly at times. But it hasn't been that way. And so we have a motion to take no action on Article 25.
Is that a proper motion or put it off to the fall?
No, take no action.
Just take no action, mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah. So we have a motion on a second. We have a second,
yes.
Sorry.
From me.
Yeah, sorry, Arthur did second that. So we have no action. On that article, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Hearing none. I rule that no action on that article.
There's no money associated with Article 26 and 27, so I move favorable action.
Favorable action on 26 and 27?
Well, 27 does include money.
Oh, there's zero here, though.
Well,
no, that's just
the 26. It's the CPC money. It's not coming from the general fund.
Right.
There's a lot of money involved in it, but it's from the CPC.
Right, but it's not out of the general fund.
26 is only the appropriation. It's routine. Right. You have to vote the appropriation by statute.
Yeah.
Now, the project one is a whole other thing.
Fortunately, they already have the money. Isn't that great?
We recommend favorable action.
Favorable action by Bill. I think I have a second to that motion. Any questions? Hearing none. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Hearing none. So ruled. We have some citizen.
Now, does this include 27
as
well?
No, it doesn't. The projects, you haven't gone through them yet.
Right.
All the projects.
27.
Yeah.
27.
The motion was 26 and 27, wasn't it?
I thought that's how we worded it.
It was 26 and he motioned 26 and 27.
Thank you.
That was my understanding.
Yes. Okay, so we'll go to Articles 28, 29, 30, and 31, which are citizens' petition articles. Article 28 is the South Shore Women's Resource Center, $3,500 We used to have it in the budget. It's now back out of the budget, Mr. Thorne, is that correct?
Yes.
So where this is a money article, are we going to vote in favor of this, for this particular cause?
I would move favorable action on behalf of the Board of Selectmen.
There's a motion, favorable action on Article 28. Is there a second? No second? Then...
I'll second it for discussion.
Okay, Dan, thank you. Second by Dan for discussion. Go ahead, Dan.
So I just wanted the town administrator to explain about this. This was an annual petition. We put it in the budget for, I don't know, 5-7 years or so.
Right.
So, and even by putting it in the budget, they still petitioned.
Correct.
Every year. So now it's out of the budget. Could you just explain that process for the public?
Well, it's real simple. We just took it out of the budget. We just, you know, didn't put it as part of our budget that we presented to the board and to the advisory committee because it's a petition article. I think a lot of times petition articles, the Board of Selectmen, a lot of times recommend town meeting floor.
And an opportunity to engage with South Shore Women's Resource Center. They're going through some changes and indicated to him that they will petition every year forever. So it's a duplication significantly of effort, time, money, paper. Just having it as a petition article allows less duplication of services, that's all. That's how they go. They do it with every other community and they're not going to
stop. I remember we had that. We decided to put it in the budget. And
I didn't know.
So we didn't have to worry about that, but I guess their procedure is to always petition.
Would it be proper to put both of these petition articles off for the fall?
No, I think they'd like to have the money available July 1st. So if you vote town meeting floor, that'll give us an opportunity to decide whether or not we can afford 28 or 29.
Because currently right now you can't, right?
Cannot, right.
Okay. So we have a suggestion from the town administrator.
Move to town meeting floor.
Town meeting floor. That's a motion by Bill to do so.
Question?
Yes.
Second. There's a motion with a second already on the floor.
Okay.
Oh, there is?
Yeah.
I'll withdraw my motion.
I'll withdraw the second.
Original motion and second have been withdrawn in favor of Bill's motion for town meeting floor.
Second.
Second by Arthur. All those in favor?
Aye.
Please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. It's 4-0. On Article 28 and 29, that's town meeting floor. Article 30 is a general bylaw amendment concerning junk cars. And Article 31 is a general bylaw amendment right to farm. These are petition articles. And we could go town meeting floor with this as well, I think. Could we, Mr. Thorn?
Yes, sir.
Move town meeting floor for Articles 30 and 31.
Motion by Arthur for town meeting floor. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Bill, and that's for both Articles 30 and 31. All those in favor of town meeting floor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, hearing none. I rule it done. I'm going to move on to, this is the special within the annual, and we have three articles. The first one is the transfer, Selectman's recommendation of favorable action on Article 1, and it's transferring from overlay surplus account a sum of money for the Board of Selectmen's general expenses, town hall expenses, wages and salary, police department general expenses, Department of Public Works, health insurance, property and liability insurance. And there's different amounts for each of those. but the money is going to be provided by a transfer from one account to another.
Recommend favorable action.
Motion by Bill for favorable action. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Arthur. All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none. It's favorable action on Article 1. Now, Article 3 is the article from the police chief to purchase equipment for the police department emergency 911 service. There is a notation here that says there is no funding source available for these items per the town accountant. If the town votes to authorize these articles 3 and 4, the money must be borrowed. So Article 3 is $25,000 to upgrade the 911 system. Is there a motion on this?
I would recommend, based on the information that we got from the town accountant today, that that $25,000 is going to be funded from overlay surplus.
Okay. So the town administrator is informing us that the $25,000 cost for this article, a source of funding, has been found. So,
favorable action.
Favorable action motion by Bill. Is that a second by Arthur? Any questions?
Mr. Thorne supporting this.
Pardon?
That you're supporting this.
Yes, sir.
Favorable action.
Okay. A motion has been made and seconded for favorable action on Article 3. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none. That's approved. And Article 4 is to see if the town will vote to raise and appropriate or transfer from available funds a sum of money to be used for the purpose of purchasing one marked police cruiser submitted by Police Chief Wall, and the estimated cost is $45,000. Do you have any information on that article, Mr. Thorne?
The thing that the town accountant and I, along with the chief, that the only way that we could pay for this cruiser right now would be to borrow the money. So the board wants to put town meeting for it, and that might give us a little time as to find out whether or not we could use some one-time money to buy a one-time capital item.
Okay.
I would move the town administrator's recommendation.
A motion by Arthur to move the recommendation of town meeting 4. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Bill. Questions? Hearing none. All those in favor of town meeting 4 on Article 4, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none. I move town meeting 4.
Question. We're on the special. Article 2, which isn't before us right now, it's a hold for April 10th. What do we anticipate hearing on April 10th, Ed? What do we expect to know on April 10th to help us make a decision or speak of it?
Well, that's when they present their financial game plan for the field itself.
Okay.
Okay. Any other issues before us on these articles? Hearing none, we will move on to a discussion of the municipal users fee abatement criteria and procedures, and I'll turn this over to Mr. Thorne.
Yeah, I've given the board some information in the past regarding these abatements, and I would like to hand out this latest information about abatements. Behind it will be a chart that'll show how much has been abated. Well, let's make sure that
Have there been changes to what you're passing out versus what we had originally?
No, I think it's just adds to the information explanation.
Oh, okay.
To your packet.
So what you have are the abatement forms and the kinds of abatements that we have. And then also a monetary chart that deals with
just started.
How many abatements have been issued by the town over the last 5 years. And so the different kinds of abatements that we have are what are called by our staff people as irregular abatements. These are changes that are made where somebody might have an in-law apartment that they're being charged two trash bills for, and they come in and, you know, it's because the assessors went through all of the units in town, and if they had any information that would suggest that somebody has an in-law apartment, then they would be assessed for that in-law apartment, and then they would be charged two tax bills. So then the resident would have to come in and inform the town that they only have one use, and so therefore we would abate one of the trash bills. Then we have the senior citizen abatement, where they're allowed a $50 abatement. And if you look at the financial chart, we've been averaging about the last 3 years, about 150 to 173 seniors have come in during the course of the year to apply for an abatement. Other means of an abatement, that means they have another means of trash pickup. You know, they have to provide proof that their employer or they have a business that has their own trash pickup, and then their trash is abated. We average between 47 and 108 abatements in that regard. Summer residents, it's pretty consistent over the last 5 years, around 44 abatements are issued for people that have summer residents in town. And so they have to apply every 6 months. They have to apply every year because we don't know whether or not somebody will have moved, sold their house to somebody that has a full-time year-round residence there. Vacant property, this is one where you have to apply every 6 months. We have about 30 to 60 people apply every year for vacant property abatements. And then the reverse is where somebody would have been charged erroneously for a bill. Now, in most cases, the abatement only is equal to 50% of the trash bill. So $140 remains as a bill to individuals to pay for the capping of the landfill and the debt service associated with that. And so that's an issue that I wanted to make the board aware of, that nobody gets a 100% abatement. If they get abated for any of the reasons that I just mentioned, their abatement is 50% at the most. Now, abatements will total anywhere from a high of $138,000 to a low of $36,000 in fiscal 2016. And then, of course, because trash bills went up from $200 a year to $280, then we had a a rush on abatements where all of a sudden people decided that either they would try to hit, you know, try to get the abatements as opposed, you know, I guess in 2016, most people didn't care about the $200 a year, but when it went to 280, that caught their attention, and then that's when about 100 people more applied for abatements than they did in 2016.
Are there any questions?
And for the board's information, the budget, the trash budget's $1.8 million a year. And that includes capping the landfill, running the recycling center, paying for a curbside trash pickup with easy disposal, and easy disposal picks up trash and recyclables. And we have to pay for the disposal of the recyclables at the Waste Management Center in Avon, although we're saving a lot more money on it this year because recycling business has really gone up. Last year we were paying $30 a ton to get rid of recyclables, and now we're paying $4 a ton. So we're saving quite a bit of money in that regard. Our disposal of trash went up 2.5% as per our contract with New Bedford Waste, but it's still $56 a ton, which is considerably less than $118 a ton we were paying CMS 4 years ago.
And twice yearly hazardous waste pickup.
Correct. Which is worth about $15,000. That's the line item for hazardous waste. So it's a good deal for the residents of town. You know, and that's part of the trash thing.
Well, I think our total trash program is a good deal for the residents of the town, and I think that's a real plus to have the trash service that we have. Are there any questions from Mr. Fawn on these abatement application forms or on his discussion?
Do you need a motion on this, Ed, or is this for discussion only?
Well, it wouldn't hurt to have a board vote on this policy.
Okay. So after hearing from Mr. Thorn on these abatement procedures, do we have a motion from the board accepting what we have heard?
Move to approve the town administrator's abatement policy as presented.
Motion by Dan, a second by Arthur. Any questions? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Approve that 5-0. The minutes of March 27th. Is there a motion?
Motion to approve the minutes of March 27th as written.
Motion by Arthur, second by Bill. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed, hearing none, that's 5-0. Old business. Does anyone have any old business to take up? I had a couple of short things. I was looking through some files, and I came across the municipal aggregation program, and I was wondering if we have any status on that bit.
No, I think it's still at the Department of Public Utilities. That's all. Seems to be a long process for towns that have wanted to enter that program.
I know this board has approved going forward with that program, so we're still waiting to hear what's going on.
I had a question.
Yes, Dan.
I haven't heard anything. I'm sure there's been discussions through you, Ed. The town veterans agent, has there been any discussion on or applications?
You beat me to my report. Absolutely.
All right. How about it?
Okay. Also, under old business, I just want to remind the board that we accepted a resignation from the Community Preservation Group Committee of a person who was one of the two representatives of this board that serve on that committee. So we are short one person that we're required to have that would represent the board. don't think we've had anybody apply for that. I don't know whether we solicited if anybody would like to come forward. So with the board's permission, I would like to ask the public if anyone has any real interest in the Community Preservation Committee and the fine work that they do. If you would like to be on that committee, please contact the Selectmen's office and we will give you all the information that you need. Thank you. Town Administrator's report?
Yeah, as Dan suggested, an update on the Veterans Agent position. We've received over a dozen applicants for that, and we believe right now we have 3 to 4 names that we would like to interview. Now, the question I have before the board is, would the board like to pick 1 or 2 members to sit in on the interviews and then present with whatever finalists they feel would be appropriate to the board for appointment?
That's what we did the last time, and it worked out well.
Mm-hmm.
This is for which position?
Veterans agent.
Oh, yeah, I would definitely like to sit on that.
Good. Thank you, Bill. I think, as Dan said, we had a representative before, and we certainly came up with a winner.
We had 2. I believe it was Bill and myself the last time.
So it's a combination we should keep together.
I concur.
Good.
Great. Thank you very much.
Let's see what we got here. Ask the selectmen, is there any issues anyone would like to bring up? Hearing none, new business. Anyone have any information? Matthew, let me just ask you. Last week you had mentioned about a hydro turbine on the North River. Do you have any information on that? I found out I couldn't really discuss that with anybody. I don't really know how that would work.
Yeah, I've hit a similar wall. I've reached out to some people and I've started to look into it, but I have nothing to report at this time.
Okay.
I'll keep looking into it.
Very good. Thank you. Thank you. Upcoming issues. On April 10th, the final review and recommendations on the warrant articles. April 24th, sign the annual and special within the annual town meeting warrants. On May 9th at 7 p.m., we are having our annual town meeting at Learning Lane in Pembroke at the high school. May 9th, 7 p.m. Please plan on attending. I hope the general public will have a good representation.
Mr. Chairman,
yes.
Would you mind just backtracking to new business for a second?
Certainly.
Since we had Matt as a representative to the public hearing regarding the marijuana article, I was just wondering if you could explain to the board, give us a brief synopsis of what happened.
Absolutely. So they voted to table the discussion of this article until June. So we're not quite sure what that means for the town meeting or for the warrant.
Until June.
They said they needed to gather more information on it.
Okay.
Can you tell us in the public what the gist of the article is?
Yes, the gist of the article is the decision on whether or not to allow the public to vote on whether or not to have retail marijuana in Pembroke. And that board voted to table the discussion.
Okay.
Unanimously, or was it a split decision?
Unanimously.
And did we have a turnout of folks that attended that public meeting? Was there a fair representation of people, or was it sparsely attended?
Fairly low. It was myself, the chief, and Lisa Cullity.
No one from the general public?
No.
Thank you, Matthew.
So does this mean that it won't go forward? Does this mean that it won't go forward for a town meeting vote?
I think it will. I mean, we'll check with town council tomorrow. Yeah. But yeah.
Did they close the public hearing?
They voted to keep it open until June.
Well, we need to investigate what that's all about, what their thinking is, and next Monday we'll have an explanation for the board as to what the plan is.
So that's an important technicality. If the planning board does not close their public hearing, does that put off a town meeting vote, number one, and a ballot vote, number two?
Well, then we're going to find that out.
It's a very important technicality, and the date of the tabling to June, obviously after town meeting and town election. So that date was chosen specifically.
We'll find that out. I'll have that answer tomorrow.
Good. Okay. Thank you, Mr. Thorne. Do we have any need for executive session?
We have a gentleman sitting there behind Sabrina. Yes, sir.
Yeah, my name is Mike Quinn. I'm not really here for any particular reason or an issue. I'm just kind of at a point now where I'm able to be involved a little bit more in the community, so I wanted to try and sit in on some of these meetings if it would be okay. I moved to Pembroke about 2.5 years ago, and like I said, I'm finally at a point now where I have time and all that, so I want to kind of get a little bit more involved in the community.
Very good. I'm sorry I didn't recognize you.
If you're available Wednesday evening, there's the Town Government Study Committee will be meeting here in Town Hall. I don't recall if it was going to be 6 or 7 o'clock.
7:30.
That's it's a less formal gathering, but it's to study how town government works and if there are ways to better it. So if you're interested, you can speak to a couple of folks there in a less more casual situation and maybe ask a couple of things that not that you couldn't ask them here, but you may feel that it's a better forum for it.
Okay, that sounds good.
And you're welcome to come here every week.
Okay.
All right.
Sounds good.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming tonight, too, by the way.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, if you have a chance to give your email and phone number to Sabrina, that would be great as well, because we have spots that open up and, we can gauge your interest in it. It's always good to have volunteers, because the town runs on volunteers.
Sounds good. Thank you.
Do we have a need for executive session? We do not. The next regularly scheduled meeting of the Board of Selectmen will be on April 10th, 1 week from this evening at 7 o'clock. So thank you very much for watching, and we'll see you next Monday night.
Thank you.